The extension of that plan is that there is a crew mission going up in September with SpaceX, and then maybe the two astronauts currently on ISS could hitch a ride back February of 2025, which seems a really long time away. Just your reaction to where we are right now, that a backup plan's needed.
You know, the great thing about this backup plan is that we have it. Because if we didn't, then I think that there would be, especially when you look at the global geopolitical environment, I think that we would have a much harder time if we didn't have this option. So it's great that we have this option. I think that's the first and most important thing. And it's important that America has two options to ferry humans safely to space. What I do see also is NASA, Boeing, and SpaceX prioritizing human safety first, as they should. So that's equally important.
There is reporting out there about NASA officials or teams within NASA sort of not being 100% aligned on what the best plan was to do. As best you can, just help our audience understand how NASA works. You know, now in this era of space, we have commercial partners, you know, leading the activity, but NASA still has a central role.
Absolutely. Well, the astronauts are NASA employees. They are NASA astronauts, and these companies have contracts with NASA. So NASA has a responsibility to review and authorize decisions, because at the end of the day, the buck stops with them. And so if you step back a few weeks ago, there was a test that was consulted, there are about 26 of the 27 jets that were fired. And the goal was to ensure that these thrusters were working properly and were meeting performance requirements. And now the team is going back and analyzing that data. So there are two reasons that could really go either way. One could say, well, you know, we've analyzed the data and we think that this Boeing aircraft can come back with the astronauts or without the astronauts. And then there is another reasoning, which is that SpaceX is really the way to go. So either way, what you see within the agency is that there are people, and this is good when you have disagreement, and now they have a bit more time, given the SpaceX mission that's going up in September, to analyze the data further. And then they will make a decision based on the performance of the thrusters, the performance of this helium leak that they are monitoring. And they will make a call mid-August based on all the information they have available. And they will obviously make a decision that includes, that prioritizes human safety first, that prioritizes a safe landing, and that also builds confidence in the system.
Well, that's what I want to ask about, Ezinne, because we just showed the chart of Boeing spending on the Starliner project, and it's been well reported, the cost overruns, the delays. How, to your mind, do NASA and Boeing as partners now go back out and bring public confidence in the program going forward?
When it works. And that's the point we're trying to get to, a point where it will work and there is confidence that's built in the system so that it can ferry humans. And then the public will have confidence in the system. But we have to get it to work first, and which is why the analysis of these firing tests that were conducted recently have to be completed. Okay. But NASA will not make a decision until they have conducted a thorough analysis and believe that the data provided moves them in one direction or another.
Ezinne, also a senior fellow at the Harvard Belfer Center, the other big piece of talk right now in the industry is China and its satellite constellation ambitions. Might they do something similar to Starlink? And if they were to, how does that work, the competition for space, the proximity of a U.S.-run constellation to a Chinese constellation? Your thoughts on that, Ezinne?
You know, what is great about this question and this scenario is that we are already living it. Before the SpaceX constellation went up, we had smaller constellations, but we still had constellations in space. And then a mega constellation was put up by a U.S. commercial company, which gave us the leverage to understand and to plan for what it would look like if a strategic competitor, in this case, a nation like China, put up constellations of their own. So through the constellation that we have up there put up by SpaceX, we have been able to have discussions and even remediations to radio astronomy issues, to night sky issues based on what the satellites can see or what they prevent us from seeing from here on Earth. We have had conversations about orbital debris, which is, you know, the amount of junk that is left in space. And we've had conversations about space sustainability and figured out policy and engineering solutions to all of these issues. And so I think that we are actually in a better place as the United States to prepare the best we can for this constellation, because we have an example up there today. If we didn't, then I think we would be in a completely different place. However, that doesn't mean that we can plan entirely, as you say, for what will happen.